So at this time, it's my pleasure to introduce the president of SAG-AFTRA, Gabrielle Carteris.
Thank you, Ileana. Thank you all for being here today, tonight. I want to, before I start, I'm so happy to see all these wonderful faces here. But before I start, I'd like to recognize a few of the people from our union. We have our secretary treasurer and local president, Jane Austin. Where are you, Jane? There you go. Thank you. We also have several of our SAG-AFTRA national and local board members who are with us. I want to thank you all for being here. Recognizing World AIDS Day. And I was shocked, actually, when I thought about it. It's been 30 years, and I look forward to the day when we say we are celebrating the fact that there is no more World AIDS Day. I want to welcome our distinguished guests. We have Joel Goldman and Naomi Wilding, who has kept... I'm looking around. There's Joel and Naomi, who has really kept her grandmother's vision and legacy alive through the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, and I want to congratulate you both for doing that. As many of you know, Elizabeth Taylor put her face to the HIV/AIDS epidemic at a time when there was an incredibly, I want to say it was an awful stigma that was attached to it. I remember in the early 80s when the AIDS epidemic, when there was that big boom, and it was thought of as being solely a gay disease, and it was a punishment to those who were gay. And thank God we had Elizabeth Taylor. It was because of her and her work in helping to speak out against the lack of public policy response by the federal government. The federal government ignored it regarding this epidemic, that everybody was turning away from it. And she raised millions and millions of dollars in research for research to find a cure. She helped to start a movement that we recognize today. Her work on behalf of those with HIV/AIDS led her to be recognized. And I don't know if you know this, but it was in 1998 she received the SAG Life Achievement Award, and that was not only for her fabulous work as an actress, but it was for her making a difference in her service to our country and to the world. She really deserved it. I can remember, as I said, the fear and the stigma that was attached to it. And so we are very proud to honor the memory of our dear friend and colleague, Elizabeth Taylor, and to recognize the incredible work that she did through her foundation. She did it. She did it at a time when others were paralyzed with fear, absolutely paralyzed, when others refused to reach out to those who were afflicted. She met the disease head on, raising money for research and offering care and love to those in need. And love was also very crucial. We've come a long way from those days, and yet there's still so much more that we have to do. Tonight is a testament to Elizabeth and to the foundation, to its leadership and staff, who still lead the way. And as Elizabeth herself said, and I quote, "Ours was one of the first industries to be directly and dramatically affected by the AIDS epidemic. It's heartening to me that this community has risen to the challenge." So tonight, let us all rise to the challenge so that we can end this celebration, or this actually acknowledgement of World AIDS Day, so that we can look back and say no more. Thank you for being here, and it promises to be a very informative evening. Thank you. Before I go away, I want to introduce the person who is the co-chair for our LGBT community committee, and not only is he an activist, but he is a fabulous actor, and that is Jason Stewart. And I need that.
God, I wish I was straight. First, I just want to say how humbled I am to be here, to be a man of a certain age, and to have passed through what a lot of other gay men have been through in this country, and to still be alive. And as the national co-chair of the Screen Actors Guild AFTRA's LGBT committee, we had started this 11 years ago with the idea of supporting each other, creating the idea of a safe place to work and equality in the workplace, and the idea that we could also create more opportunity for each other. I also want to mention today some of the actors that I have come to work with, meet, and serve with us on this committee who have passed. First, I would say Alexis Arquette, who was part of the committee who sat right here, Ellen, I believe, on our first caucus, am I correct? And she, or he, because she went back and forth quite a bit, and I just adored her. And I think in this business, a lot of times we don't want to say to people that we are sick if we have an illness, whether it be breast cancer or any other kind of cancer, any other kind of disease, because people will think that we won't be available for work. And we all don't want anybody to see us in that way. Alexis, for me, as a colleague and a friend, was always someone willing to show up if you talked her into it enough. And I also want to talk about Michael Jeter, who was the first person I ever met. We used to work out together at the gym. You know him from Evening Shade and The Green Mile, and he passed from AIDS. And this man was amazing, and certainly the first person I ever met that actually said that he was HIV positive, and people knew, and he continued to work and continued to live an openly out proud gay life. He was an example to me. And the last person I'll speak about is a guy you probably don't even know. His name is Barry Robin. And when I was in my early 20s, you might know him from the film that Stanley Kramer directed, Bless the Beast and the Children. He played Cotton. And this was a man that I met when I was very, very young, who put out his hand to me and showed me the way. And I want to mention his name today because he passed and was a wonderful actor. And this is a disease that I hope one day that they do find a cure for in my lifetime. And I just want to say to you all today, thank you so much for letting me be of service. Thank you very much.
Sorry, I'm not a public speaker, so forgive if I stumble.
This is Naomi.
Thank you.
No one told me.
I'm here to introduce this video tribute to my amazing grandmother, Elizabeth Taylor, which I hope will not just remind everyone of her extraordinary strength and talent, but most of all, of how she saw an opportunity to use her fame to help others, specifically to help ease the suffering of and shine a light on those who have been affected by HIV and AIDS. At the end of her life, when I knew her best, she proudly spoke of her activism as having been her life's greatest work. It was my grandmother's wish to see an end to AIDS within her lifetime. Sadly, that wasn't possible. It's now 35 years since the beginning of the epidemic, and we do have the science and the tools to see an end to AIDS in the United States, but we still haven't achieved it. Stigma persists, new HIV diagnoses remain constant each year and rise amongst our young people. For example, the rate of HIV/AIDS incidence in Atlanta has been compared to that of developing countries in sub-Saharan Africa. What has held us back from our goal is lack of education and visibility around the facts of HIV and AIDS themselves, and lack of tolerance towards the very people who are most at risk. This panel, this union, and this audience are uniquely positioned to use their platform, their outlets, and their creativity to engage more people in the fight, to educate people on the facts, not fears, and to decrease the stigma that perpetuates HIV. Thank you.
I'm Joel Goldman, the Managing Director of the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation. First, I want to thank Gabrielle, Jason, Naomi for your remarks that have really set an incredible tone for tonight, and also to Ileanne and Ellen and the SAG-AFTRA team for helping us pull this together and partnering with us on this eve of World AIDS Day. Now I'd like to invite the panelists up one by one, and we'll start here with David Arquette, activist and actor and director and producer and a lot of other things, and I'm good for that. Next in will be Tarell Alvin McCraney. He's the playwright and author of In Moonlight, Black Boys Look Blue, and the writer, story writer of Moonlight. Next to Tarell, we have Dr. Michael Gottlieb, an immunologist and HIV AIDS expert, and we'll get more into his bio in a bit. And next to Dr. Gottlieb, we will have Chandi Moore. She is an HIV and trans activist and was a fabulous mentor to Caitlyn Jenner on I Am Cait. And next to Chandi, we have Jaime Presley, an AIDS activist for a long time that I've worked with, an Emmy-winning actress for My Name is Earl, and currently co-starring on my favorite TV show, Mom. If she knows and my friend, Neal Baer, who is a doctor, a television producer, and a writer, and we'll hear more about his life too. Neal, please join me. So I'll start by saying this past summer was the 21st International AIDS Conference, and actress Charlize Theron opened the conference this year. And I just want to read one little quick excerpt of her speech because it really resonates with me. I hope we won't keep meeting like this. Since the first International AIDS Conference in 1985, we have been counting up all the way to 21. Now it's time for us to start counting down. We have set a goal to end the AIDS epidemic by 2030. Tomorrow is the 28th World AIDS Day, and I wholeheartedly agree with Charlize. It's time for us to stop counting up with these World AIDS Days, and like some of the speakers said before me, it's time that we see an end to it. The tools exist in this world to end this, but to do that, we must really re-educate and reinvigorate the public, which is why we're so glad to partner with SAG-AFTRA tonight, because we really believe the entertainment industry played a huge role at the beginning of this disease and can play a huge role again when we need that extra shot. First, I want to start with Dr. Michael Gottlieb to sort of set the tone in terms of where we're at today. As managing director of the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, I count my blessings that he serves on our advisory board as our chief medical advisor. He spent 35 years ago this past June, Dr. Gottlieb wrote the first memo on what we now call AIDS on the first five cases that were identified here in LA. And he sent that to the CDC, and that marks the 35th anniversary of AIDS. Aside from that, he has been notably the doctor to Rock Hudson, to Ariel and Elizabeth Glazer as well, and he plays a role in the life of the Elizabeth Taylor story because he and Elizabeth started something called the National AIDS Research Foundation, which later merged with Dr. Matilda Krim's foundation on the East Coast to become today what we know as AMFAR. So many of us, including myself, who's been HIV positive for 25 years, are alive because of those medicines that have been discovered because of the work that AMFAR did. And he's still... And he still is a practicing HIV physician, not just miles away from here. So... Dr. Gottlieb, let me start with this question for you. We always say we have all the tools to end this epidemic. What can you explain to the audience? What are the tools? How can we get there?
Well, thank you, Joel. There are quite a few tools that we have to end this epidemic. We've made remarkable progress in a very short time. I know it seems like an eternity to many of us, most of us, but the progress scientifically in the last 35 years has been dramatic. We still don't have a couple of tools that we really need, and one of those is a vaccine, and the other is a cure. But what we do have is the scientific apparatus and the commitment to find those things. In the United States and in many countries, incredible research is being done on those two things, vaccine and cure. But to answer your question more directly, we have a test, a very accurate test for HIV, which is underutilized. And next, we have treatments for HIV, the so-called cocktail combination antiviral therapy, or HART, which is incredibly effective at improving the prognosis for a person with HIV and reducing the risk of transmission of HIV. That's one of the principal spillover effects of antiviral therapy. Not only does it help the individual, but it helps reduce the transmission of HIV. And lastly, we have a test to measure the level of virus in the blood and render people undetectable and let them know that they're in fact undetectable. And so I'll close by saying that the World AIDS organization, the UNAIDS, has set a goal of 90-90-90 by the year 2020. And what that means is that people living with HIV in the world today, 90% of them will know their status by 2020. They'll have been tested. 90% will be engaged in therapy, and 90% will be undetectable. And that, of course, is the gold standard for benefiting their own health and reducing the risk of transmission to others. And for the moment, that's the best we can do in the absence of those last two things, vaccine and cure. And there are major efforts afoot to address those two deficiencies.
Great. Thank you. Let me follow up and say, I mean, you've been in this fight since day one, and when you wrote that memo, and before that, and when you had those five patients. Is there anything about the last 35 years that surprises you, either how far we've come or where we haven't gotten to?
Well, as I've said, the scientific progress has been amazing. The social progress has been less amazing. There's still a huge stigma, the stigma that was mentioned in the film with Elizabeth, the stigma that she rose to the occasion to address, which was rampant in the early 80s. And while I think with time attitudes have softened a little bit, I think it's still very hard for people living with HIV and AIDS today. And we need help in reducing and eliminating that stigma. And that's the surprise to me, is how it's hung on.
And I totally agree with you. I have to say, I think most Americans believe, because when they hear what I do for a living, a lot of people go, oh, that's still a thing, that still exists. And the truth of the matter is, we haven't seen a reduction in new infections in the US in over 20 years. And in fact, in 2014, UNAIDS put out a report that said 61% of all HIV in the world is in just 10 countries. US falls number 9 on that list. And we're surrounded by 8 sub-Saharan countries and India. We're really the only westernized country that hasn't really figured it out. And stigma, I would say, is probably the biggest reason.
And let me just jump in for a sec, Joel, to say that the United States, this gold standard of undetectable, the United States as a country at large, only 40% of people living with HIV in the United States today have achieved that undetectable state. And so that's... There's a huge task ahead.
So it really starts with that first 90. The best thing we can do is that we need to get 90% of all the people tested to know their status, and that's what that first 90 means in order to start that pathway to see the end of AIDS. I really do believe that in the beginning, in the 80s, when this was all, everyone was in fear and people didn't know, I really believe that it was the entertainment industry that helped quell the fears of America, helped educate people. Films like Longtime Companion and The Band Played On and Early Frost, Philadelphia, they helped humanize AIDS for everybody. But it really wasn't until 1996. It wasn't until 1996 when ER brought on the character of Jeannie Boulay, who was the first HIV-positive character on scripted television. And I'm thrilled to have my friend Neal Baer here tonight, who's an MD turned entertainment executive, and he created and wrote Jeannie Boulay's role that was flawlessly played by Gloria Rubin on ER. Neal, can you tell us about the character development of Jeannie and the genesis of the storyline that lasted for three seasons?
Sure. Thanks for having me tonight. So Gloria's character, Jeannie Boulay, was the first, not the first positive character, but the first primetime leading character that didn't die of HIV, a terrible death. And so I was a fourth-year medical student when I came to do ER the very first season. And I went to John Wells, and we talked about, in the first season, all we had was AZT. And when I was a medical student from 91 to 96, until, as Joel just said, of 95 and 96, and Michael said, when antiretrovirals were available, there wasn't a lot we could do. And people did die, and all the movies you just, and TV movies you just mentioned, everyone died in those films. Philadelphia, An Early Frost, One Time Companion, all of those films. And so we wanted to, from my own experience of seeing people going from death's door to living, being on antiretrovirals, and as, at that time, a closeted gay man, I wanted to do a story that really showed a different point of view. So we asked Gloria, who herself had dealt with HIV because of a family member who had died of AIDS, and she agreed to play this character, and it really hadn't been seen on television, particularly a healthcare provider. So we were able to really explore what it meant and all the fears. And I remember doing scenes with Anthony Edwards and George Clooney where their characters really, you know, sort of epitomized both the fears and the great courage that that doctors had, the whole sort of gamut of what we were doing. And it was just really a real privilege and honor to be able to do that with Gloria. And what was great about it was in year 14, I'd left the show after year 7. To go on to other shows, but I asked John to bring Gloria back to show that a character could be happy, healthy, active, and living a really positive life, being HIV positive, and they did. And so that was really like a wonderful moment, I think, for ER in year like 14 out of year 15 when Gloria went back on the show to play Jeannie Boulay. And we're seeing that now. And, you know, when we did a study, we found that we thought that people's favorite scenario would be Clooney and Juliana and their love story, and that was the second favorite. But the favorite was Gloria's story on ER, and we were really surprised. And I think it was because it moved people and it opened, you know, people's eyes and hearts. And that's, for me, always been the motivating factor of all the work I do is, you know, not teaching or educating, but just to, you know, tell a story that can open hearts. So I've been lucky to be able to tell that story with Gloria's character.
It was great. As somebody who was HIV positive at the time watching it, it meant a lot to see that storyline playing out. So personally, I thank you, and I've told that to you before. I want to follow up with, you know, you mentioned the study about ER, but also Kaiser Family Foundation in 2002 did a study to see the effects that ER was having on public health. And I have some of those numbers. More than half of regular viewers of ER who were surveyed reported that they learned about important health issues, including HIV and AIDS, from watching that show. One third of viewers said they had gotten information from ER that helped them make choices about their own family, their own health, or their family's health care. And one in five doctors said that they actually were consulted by people, viewers of the show, who came in to talk about certain diseases. So, I mean, again, the whole point of tonight is to say we need more of this, and that show really was groundbreaking, and Kaiser really put it together that it really did work. So thank you. Neal, you've also been busy since then, and with Law & Order SVU, a little show that you do, producing and writing, and I noticed that the Tonys this year.
I'm Olivia Benson. I'm Tutuola, and I'm Elliot Stabler. It's my bunch.
How many people you gave their starts to, because at the Tonys they did that whole year.
Lots of actors. You know, when Patricia Mara came in, I said, who is that? And just right when she walked in, that's Rooney, and we gave Rooney Mara her first, literally her first job as she walked in. Lee Pace, so many different actors. And we continue doing, you know, HIV storylines. about on the down low, HIV deniers with Martin Mull's character. It was an amazing episode. HIV in Congo. I mean, it was just like a real pleasure for me to continue to do those kinds of stories and move it into, you know, even into the present. So, you know, I am a little nervous about what's going to happen to people with HIV. And as Michael Gottlieb said, you know, between 30% and 40% of people are treated, and their viral load is undetectable. So what does that mean? We should just talk about that for 1 second, if I can. What does that mean in this country when we have antiretrovirals available and Truvada, PrEP, so we can prevent HIV and we can treat it so that there should be no transmission? And why is it in this country today that at most only 40%, you know, are fully treated? And that's a question and a problem of stigma, and particularly men and women of color having access. So it's something that, you know, we want to continue telling stories about.
Absolutely. And also, I'm just curious, what is, you know, not everybody puts social issues into TV shows. I've been pitching them for years for all the charities I've worked for, and not everybody's receptive, but you do it on your own. So what's your motivation, and why should others do it?
Well, I think it's because I'm a physician. I'm doing a pilot for Fox about hate crimes, of all things. And it just is like, I guess I was prescient in July when I pitched it and sold it, and now I'm like a little bit, not a little, I'm horrified at how that's come to pass. And so whether it'll go or not, I don't know, but I guess I've just always been driven, maybe it was partly also because of my being in the closet, that rather than being homophobic, I tried to do as many stories as possible about HIV and kids with HIV and gay kids who didn't want to come out of the closet, and making Laura Innes' character a lesbian on ER, and making Ice-T's son gay on SVU. It's like, if you look at like kind of my past, it's like, why was Neal Baer so interested in doing all this? So I was like, well, the answer was because I was gay. So so I think that was part of it too, feeling this pressure my whole life until I came out about 3.5 years ago. But it was a conduit for me to tell stories that I was really passionate about, but still be a little self-protected. So I guess it's just that passion for storytelling that I do think that's the way that change can come about, by telling these stories and seeing, you know, Gloria's character, she wasn't going to infect anyone she was treating. I mean, people really thought that in 1995, 1996, we had a great scene with Anthony Edwards saying, you know, we're gonna fire you because you know, people are too afraid to be with you, to be around you. And, you know, and Laura Innes' character said, no, we're not going to do that. And it's like they were articulating the battles that were going on in the country. And it's like such a privilege to be able to work with amazing actors and writers and directors to articulate those stories. So, you know, I've been fortunate.
And we need more of it today. And I'll tell you, in some ways, Jeannie Boulay's storyline was really even ahead of its time. Today in this country, black women now account for 60% of all women who are HIV positive in this country. And in fact, 47% of all new infections in the US are in the black community. And we have to contrast that with that the black community is only 12% of the US population. So there's a huge disparity. But I think the greatest disparity for me in this epidemic right now is that one out of every two black men who have sex with men will be infected with HIV by the time they're 35. Let that sink in a minute. One out of two black men who have sex with men will be infected with HIV by the time they're 35. This year's critically acclaimed film, Moonlight, is a brilliant portrayal of the forces that create that kind of stigma that make HIV a challenge in the black community. And I'm so honored that Tarell is here with us, the playwright and author of the play first and then the story for the movie. Tarell also made a trip specially from Miami. He doesn't live in Los Angeles, and he just flew in from Miami for today to just be part of this panel. So we really appreciate that effort too. Well, the film, so my question for you is, while the film did not speak directly to the AIDS epidemic, it certainly set the stage for the stigma that has created the disparity of the infection rate in the black community, I know you have been, you have personally experienced the epidemic in your life, and I was wondering if you could share just part of your story, if you'd be open to that.
Sure. I think, hi. My when I was 13 years old, my mother was diagnosed with HIV, and she was so terrified to tell me that she put me on a three-way call with her and a nurse, and the nurse said, okay, well, because of your status, we have to do X. And because of the way the nurse was speaking in coded language, I picked up that my mother was telling me that she was positive. And so when the nurse hung up the phone, my mom said, do you understand? I said, of course, I know. And from that day forward, what was interesting about that, and the reason I bring it up tonight is because that is, you know, that legacy of suffering and silence was not new to my family. My grandmother, my mother's mother, had lung cancer and didn't tell my mother and passed away, and my mother found out she had been battling with lung cancer all that time. And so, but how do, so for example, and we're this is talking about representation, how do we know, how do we, what are the telltale signs of that? How did I know what status was in the conversation with the nurse, and how did my mother figure out that her mother had died or had lung cancer? Well, because she'd seen enough movies and TV shows that when, once somebody coughs into a napkin and there's blood in it, that probably means that there's some sort of emphysema or something happening. Mm-hmm. So that representation was teaching her about illness. And sometimes when we approach the understanding of what HIV is, we often talk about teaching science, right? Which, as I'm sure the doctor will be able to tell us, it's not easy, right? But there are other ways in which we can talk about how illness happens. Illness is a part of the human experience. And it, thus being a part of the human condition, we must then make it a part of the human storytelling. It must be a part of the way in which we tell stories. So that was always important to me as a reminder of how to represent people. And I remember I used to do HIV and AIDS prevention theater as a kid because of it, because of that one conversation. Yes.
And so from your perspective, though, you're from originally from Atlanta, now live in Miami. And
originally from Miami.
Oh, did I get wrong? Sorry.
That's
do,
okay.
Do you live in Atlanta?
No, still in Miami.
Okay. I made that up. Sorry, Ron.
That's all right.
Do you like Atlanta? Have you been there? All right. So you live in the
My
South.
My parents are from Georgia. That's
where it's okay. That's what I was saying. Okay. but so I guess... I don't know if people realize this, but the epicenter of the HIV epidemic in the U.S. right now is in the U.S. Southeast. 7 of the 10 states that have the highest rates of infection and cases are below the Mason-Dixon line on the East Coast. So living in that hotbed, I mean, and as in your community, how do we get to the root of the issue? How are you hearing more people talking about it, or what do we need to do?
If we Google right now the films dealing with HIV and AIDS, they come up like The Band Played On, Philadelphia, some of the ones mentioned, some of the TV shows. And if you look at over the 35 plus years that we've been battling this epidemic, who has been hit the hardest and then recovered, right? Those numbers are no longer the center of the mm-hmm. epidemic. And who hasn't, you can see a parallel.
Absolutely.
Right? Within the GLBT community, particularly for people who are not of color, we have representation. It is there. It is strong. It is linked to heroes, right? I know who Larry Kramer was before I went to Yale, before I went to undergrad. I knew who he was. I knew who Elizabeth Taylor was, and I knew her fight against the epidemic before I knew her movies. Because I was a stupid kid, mostly.
No, you're a smart one.
But I remember also having to extrapolate other stories. I remember watching Forrest Gump, and that was the first time I cried for my mother being positive because I saw Jenny, played by the indomitable Robin Wright, dying or becoming sick. I remember the first time I saw somebody who was poor on 90210, when Gabrielle Carteris took Brandon Walsh to her house. Now, it sounds funny, but that was the first time someone had done what I had did in Magnet Program, which is take someone to their house and go, I'm sorry. Wow. I know I don't live like you live. So when we talk about why the stigma exists, when we talk about resources and research, we're not often bringing into the conversation representation. We're not bringing in the conversation ability to allow these the people we want to reach to be at the center of the conversation. We're not talking, those stories aren't the ones that I can go into the archives. Where are the movies about Alvin Ailey? I had to learn Alvin Ailey died of HIV AIDS almost 20 years after I first saw Revelations, the incredible piece that changed so many lives in modern dance. And that hasn't gone away. That hasn't changed. I'm looking out and I see my friend who created a wonderful piece that braids those stories together. The stories are there. They just don't make it to where we actually can see them and they reflect. Hopefully social media is changing that, right? Hopefully our access to those stories is becoming more intimate. But we have a responsibility in that way to engage the community and give those heroes to the people.
Perfect. Perfect answer. All right. Next, Chandi. Chandi Moore. Trans women are another segment of society with a huge disparity of HIV infection rates. Globally, a trans woman is 49 times more likely to be infected with HIV than a cisgender woman, and more than 1 in 4 trans women in the U.S. are living with HIV. So Chandi, as a trans black woman, all the odds have been stacked against you in terms of HIV. But yet you have remained HIV negative. You also educate and influence at-risk young trans youth through your job at LA Children's Hospital. What's your secret, girlfriend?
Well, the secret for me is to recognize the fact that I'm not the only one struggling with my sexuality. Everyone does the same things that I do occasionally, and it's up to you to love yourself enough to do the right thing at the right time. Now, do we always do that? No, we don't. But that's something that we have to deal with ourselves. And I tell my young people all the time that they have to do what they have to do to get to where they need to go. But in the process of doing that, one must take care of oneself. And I think that the reason why I've been so blessed to be in this space is because I don't forget that. I don't forget that I'm human just like everyone else that's sitting out here. I'm just a trans woman of color where you may be something else. But we all face these same things. And it's really about being able to have conversations with your family, with your friends, but most importantly, your partners around HIV and STDs. I mean, we do have all these things that are accessible to people to stay negative, but they've got to go get it. We can't hold their hand and take them to the doctor when they're positive because they need treatment. They should be going because they need to be better for themselves. So we have to continue to find ways to keep people encouraged to stay in care when they become positive.
Absolutely. And the other thing that I want to bring up, since we're talking about TV, and you know, we were in New York together for the UN Foundation's Social Good Summit, where Chandi was on a panel with Elizabeth Taylor's grandson and Ambassador Burks of PEPFAR. And we went out to dinner that night, and we talked about the moment that trans is having, this trans moment on TV in both scripted and reality programming. But yet, you know, other than this fall, season 3 of Transparent, where they went deep into a conversation about PrEP and that she was telling the man she was about to have sex with that she was HIV positive, we really haven't seen so much dialogue in scripted trans TV, or even on your show, I Am Cait. I don't remember an episode where HIV came up. So my question is, Did you all talk about it? It feels natural as you were mentoring Caitlyn Jenner about the trans community, and did it get edited out, or is it just, what's your thoughts on that?
It definitely got edited out. We went to, while we were in New York for Gay Pride weekend, when marriage went legal, we did some outreach with some of the girls in, I want to say it was maybe the Bronx or Harlem, I'm not sure, but we did get on the bus and talk to people who were coming to get tested. We gave out flyers and talked to people on the corners, but of course we couldn't do too much because once people start recognizing Cait, then it went another direction for us, but we did have conversations around HIV on the show. I just hate that that scene got edited out, like a lot of other good stuff. But we definitely have to, you know, stay focused on that. And of course, Cait is not interested in that kind of thing right now. She doesn't like to talk about stuff like that. So we didn't really push the envelope to have conversations around that because she would remind us that she has 10 kids and I don't know how many grandkids, and she's just not interested in having that type of relationship with anyone right now. She's focused on her happiness and living her life as her authentic self, comfortably.
Why do you have a feeling, though, in general, why we're not seeing the intersection of HIV and trans in all these TV shows? I mean, or do you have any reason to know why the editors or producers decided we're not going to put, because it sounds like an amazing scene that really would have educated America?
My view is that people are just still not wanting to talk about it. They're acting as if it's gone away, and it hasn't. I remember when I was in high school, I used to see billboards all around LA for HIV testing and all these things. And people are still afraid to talk about it. I mean, parents are still afraid to talk to their children about sex. And their children are the ones who are in this area between 18 and 24, this high infection rate. So why are we still hiding this conversation from people? You know, we have to break those barriers down and those stigmas and start having conversations. I mean, my mother had it with me, but she's a lot different than the average parent. But I mean, she was willing to do it. And I think that all parents should do it. And people in general, teachers, it needs to be in schools, you know, the health education in schools now, you know, they're limited to what they can say and how much of it they can say. So, I mean, again, we have to break down those walls and just start having these conversations, period.
Absolutely. And it's not happening, as you alluded to, it's not happening in the schools either. The Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation each year sponsors something called AIDS Watch, which is the largest grassroots movement to Capitol Hill to lobby for various bills that are needed in the HIV AIDS community. And last year we took on comprehensive sexual health education in the U.S. because the truth is many states, or most of the states, and most of the states where you see the largest numbers of HIV have chosen abstinence-only based education. And we know that young people are having sex, and the infection rates in these states show that they are, but yet we're only teaching abstinence, which makes it more important, in my opinion, for you all, the entertainment industry, to come in. Because, you know, you look at Glee, and you look at young people's attitudes towards gay marriage and gay relationships, and Glee was such a watch by that generation. And when they did the surveys of, like, young Republican, I don't remember the numbers, they all approved gay marriage. And so I feel like, I guess I'm begging you all tonight, I feel like TV, I feel like activists like you, Chandi, and Jaime, who we're going to get to next, can really make a difference. And Jaime and I first met when I was working at the Elizabeth Glazer Pediatric AIDS Foundation. And one day I get a phone call from a publicist, her publicist, who says, I have this actress, and she's on this the show Jack and Jill. This is probably around 99, 2000.
Very long time ago.
You were very young. 99, 2000. And she just wants to have a young girl with HIV to the set one day. It's not for a press purpose. It's not going to be a photographer. It's not going to be a photo. She just wants to do something magical for a young girl with AIDS. And so we sent, and I got to go with her, and that's where we began our friendship and working relationship with young Christina. So I want to ask you two questions. One, what inspired you to do that? And then I'd love to know how Christina is today.
Truthfully, what inspired me was the behavior that was going on set of the, how should I put it, very entitled actors. And I felt like there was a need to put things in perspective. And also because AIDS, my Uncle Alan was one of the first 7 in North Carolina to be diagnosed with AIDS in the 80s. And we found out, they thought he had Hep C. And we found out what it was. I was 7 or 8 years old. It was the very first article ever written. I'll never forget it. My memory is like a blessing and a curse, because I remember too much. But my aunt was sitting next to me, and we were looking at people, and she flipped it through, and I remember seeing AIDS really big on the left side in block letters, and then the article, and there was the symptoms, and there was a picture of a man that looked just like my Uncle Alan, who was in a hospital bed dying of Hep C, supposedly. And I remember my aunt looking at me and going, oh my God, my brother's dying. And we took that magazine to the hospital, and that's how he was diagnosed with AIDS, from People magazine. They didn't know what it was. They had no idea. And so we had them test for all of the stuff, and all the symptoms were accurate. And so they had to make calls to all these other doctors and everything. And unfortunately, there was not, you know, the medicine that we have now, we didn't have at the time, and we lost him about a year later. The thing that got me so much was that my grandmother, she insisted that he had leukemia. And here, this is North Carolina, one of the places that I thought you were showing me a Democrat-Republican map of the U.S. that day, remember? Mm-hmm. Because all to the right of the country and the southern area was all red, and I'm like, well, that's Republican. Why are you showing me this? And you're like, no, that's AIDS. North Carolina was all red. And that baffles me, because it just reminds me that it's still, the stigma is still real. It's just like my grandmother, who came from the old day where you don't admit fault. To this day, on the death certificate of my uncle, it says that he died of pneumonia. And technically, it was pneumonia that got him, but he died of AIDS. How could you not? I mean, we allowed them to, which she didn't want, but the whole family, we had to step over her on that. We wanted them to be able, they did an autopsy so they could, you know, for research. He was my favorite uncle. I had no idea what gay was. I just knew I loved my Uncle Alan and my Uncle Terry. It never occurred to me. Plus, he cut hair, and he loved to shop. I mean, we were besties.
My nieces would tell you gay uncles are great, too.
They're the best. So, for me to hear my grandmother, like, I wrote a paper my freshman year in high school back there that won, and it killed her, because it was about my Uncle Alan. And about what I saw, and about how painful his death was, and how we need to find a cure. They wouldn't let me in the room, and so I had to look at him through the window, because I'd catch it in the air. You know, just, there's still people that think that way. And that's the thing, like, I wish I was more savvy on social media, because
And I will try, I will be when the time is
right. I'm going to get you an intern who will help you.
Okay, let's do that. Because obviously social media affects everything, including the president.
That's sad, isn't it?
But there's got to be some way that we can bring awareness to these communities still that aren't being spoken to. And why you don't give condoms out at school anymore, because that's gonna tell kids that it's okay to have sex. There's all these things that there's no sex education at all in most schools.
Did you hear what a Texas legislator wants to do recently?
Right.
Pass a law in Texas that forces teachers to out their students to their parents.
What?
Yes. So I think
how
we have to.
That a law?
Well, it hasn't passed yet, but that was that's been introduced in the Texas state legislature.
But I also think that what you bring up about social media is really important in that I'm not as savvy as I should be. However, I read a lot of social media, right? I'll get on Twitter and read a lot. And what I recognize is that a lot of young people of color, a lot of young people of color identifying as queer and transgender, particularly who can have advocacy and a voice in these areas, are aware. They have the awareness. There are other elements to it, right? So let's say I'm aware of something, but if I don't see it out in the world, my awareness all day long is just in my little bubble,
right?
If that makes any sense.
Yeah.
It's the same awareness that keeps somebody from saying, okay, I have Obamacare right now, and I can afford the $1,500 that it costs to get medication because of Obamacare right now, but when that is written away or passed away, what will I do next? Without those people aren't asking those questions, so the numbers might get worse, and so I'm not debating you. You're right. It is a question of awareness, but it's also about how we have circular conversations, conversation community. The theater where I work, the theater in which you work, the arenas where we work, they keep a discourse alive. Mm-hmm. And that's so important, because if people think they're just speaking to themselves, then it's easier to suffer alone. But once you, like you said, you see something, you saw something said to you, this is happening, and it began a dialogue with you, right? And that's a part of how we can heal. We have to have a culture of healing that we do not have currently, which is why other countries, like when I lived in London for forever, my friend tested positive and was like, oh, I'll go to the clinic and we'll start regimens, and they talked to him and they put him on the things that he was supposed to do, and there was already and they set him up with the doctors without even talking about it. I was like, I don't even know, every 3 months that I go get tested is a gauntlet, right? Uh-huh. It's a terrifying moment of sort of going, well, what will happen now? Who will pay for it? Will my insurance still keep me? And those conversations and questions are a part of that, are the nuance of that awareness that you speak about, that I think we have a responsibility to do too. Does that make sense?
Absolutely.
And it starts with your story, Jaime. You just said that your story of your uncle is what inspired you to make that call, probably, to Joel. So everybody here is interested, because they wouldn't be here if they weren't. So they all have, each one of you has a story that can be shared in some way, as you're just saying too, through social media or through the work you do or through your friends or however. And I'm still a very firm believer in the power of storytelling to promote social change, because otherwise we have nothing.
Absolutely.
So it's like, so we have to take our own stories, as you just told us, this really powerful story, and we won't forget that tonight. And hopefully will inspire us to tell our stories and ask other people to share their story.
It's such a thing, like, that's taught by the parents, you know, and each generation gets better, but there's some that stay the same. When every generation has been in the little town and it's generation after generation and nobody ever gets out, I'm like the black cat of the family, you know, because I totally disagree. I'm a complete Democrat. I do not. I like went so far away from what I was raised to believe, because it was such a box, you know? Right. And I think a lot of kids there would love to get out of the box and would love to think freely, but they feel like they can't.
Right.
because they don't want to be scrutinized.
It's amazing that you would mention those stigmas. One of my youth was just talking to me about 2 weeks ago. She disclosed to her roommates, she's 23, and her roommates are in that same age bracket. She disclosed to them that she was HIV positive, and all of them said they needed to run out and get tested.
All of our my girlfriends, you want me to tell that story?
I want to tell you a story, because I like this.
When we were 15, and I had just moved out to California, I had always thought, they said it could take 7 years before you can, you know, detect it. I was always like, what if I have it? Because I just was all up on my Uncle Alan, no matter what. I didn't care. And my mom would let me because she's like me. She's a dance teacher. She's an artist. She was like, be free, you know. Everybody else was like masking and, you know. And we all went together to get tested. Of course, there's six of us girls who are all still best friends to this day. We go to the free clinic to get tested. Now, I'm the last one they call in. This is just every time. I get called in last, and I'm the one that's actually worried. Even though I know it's ignorant to think what I was brought up to believe, I still had it in my head. I go in there to get my results, and I'm sitting there, and the guy, it takes forever to come in. And then when he does, he sits down, he opens the file, and he goes... I'm like...
Thank you, sir.
I have it. And he goes, damn it, I got the wrong file. I have been doing this all day. That's not something you do to somebody. That's terrible. But the thing is the girls and I, we all went together. And that's what I think we need to promote more, is getting everybody together. Go with your friends, go do it together. And there was a free clinic at the time.
Well, and you might be able to speak to this, doctor, but just sickness in general in our society has a stigma.
Yeah.
Right? We don't treat the unwell well here.
We don't. I think that... you know, there's limits to people's ability to have empathy. I think on an individual basis, when you come to me and you tell me a story, I can be empathic. You know, it's part of my job. But I think the average person may not be equipped to be empathetic. I think society at large isn't equipped. We don't treat people with illness well. And I think the people in this room have the ability, through the medium, to have characters that we're sympathetic toward, and to reduce the stigma associated with cancer, and the big C, HIV. We're just not seeing enough of it. I mean, most we want to be entertained, I guess, and most of our characters on television are well, and so you know. It may be considered a downer to have characters who aren't well, but it really is an important role of think of the medium to humanize, to make people more human and to see illness and suffering. I wanted to jump in just to say that one of the themes I'm hearing tonight is that there's this enormous need for education. To reach North Carolina, to reach your town. A lot of people here have done this already. Neal's done it, knows the power of stories to teach people. We need to have education for sex education to get to kids if the schools aren't going to get there. And so whatever barriers are existing to discussing sex on television, I think could well come down. And then LGBT characters in the medium, in television and movies. And HIV, there's some educational needs. The reason that only 40% of people in this country with HIV are undetectable is because they are not being engaged in care and kept in care the way you do. You have to convey love to your patients, that you love and respect them, and that they are worthy, and that they need to take care of themselves and step forward and be engaged in care. And lastly, this issue of PrEP.
How to Get Away with Murder talked about it, finally. How to Get Away with Murder, the show.
Finally.
They have a character. They've talked about it all season. They both got tested. One got on PrEP. The other one is positive. It's been such a great... But then they also talked about not being... When they broke up, the one who's positive can't get a date. And he's honest about being positive.
Well, it's great, but not everybody watched that show. So we need more shows that deal with PrEP. For those of you who may not know what PrEP is taking medicine when you're HIV negative to prevent acquiring HIV, and it's incredibly effective. But it's underutilized. You look at the outsized risk of HIV among African-American men of color, African-American men, it's enormous. And yet, it's underutilized in that population, and that could play a major role in reducing the risk of acquiring HIV.
Part of that is because they make it very difficult to get in a lot of areas.
Mm-hmm. It's difficult to get. Yeah.
And it doesn't cover STDs. It only covers HIV.
It only covers HIV. It's costly. And in some states, it's particularly hard to get.
I've met people as I've traveled who, and usually, sorry to pick on the U.S. South, but usually like in Tennessee or in Georgia, and they have doctors who will say, I'm not going to put you on PrEP because that will encourage promiscuity.
Same thing as giving condoms.
Right. And sometimes the only times I've heard of some of these Southern doctors who won't do it is if they're in a relationship where one's positive and one's negative, serodiscordant, because then they want to protect the one because you're already having sex. But if you just went in and said, I want PrEP, a lot of people, they're not like you, Dr. Gottlieb. I send people in to get PrEP.
But so. It's hugely underutilized, as you're pointing out. And in the absence of a vaccine, it's really the best thing that we have.
Mm-hmm.
If we had a vaccine, we wouldn't need PrEP. People wouldn't have to take medicine every day.
What percent of doctors don't, and nurses? There was like a really high percentage I read who really don't even understand it or know about it yet. So it's
an education. It is a
storytelling problem. And, you know, and it's an issue, you know, in L.A., it's a pretty good place, and Sheila Kuehl has really actually fought hard to make it available, but there's a lot of stigma in African-American community, Hispanic community, churches, things like that. It's hard, you know, you can't just set up a gay men's health center in Compton and expect African-American men to go, so how do you design new ways to do it. So one thing we're talking about is, so how do we get creative with our stories so we can go on Grindr, and I've been talking to the person who founded it, and we can geolocate messages to various areas saying, here's where you can go to get PrEP, here's where you can go to get tested anonymously, here's where you can go to get ARVs, so that we can use social media, as you were just talking about and you were bringing up, we can use social media in interesting new ways. And so we're talking about doing that with Grindr, actually, and how do we go into communities of color where, you know, if you go
mobile unit.
Yeah, and you can take a mobile unit, but you can also just use Grindr to do that, to target people who may not, you know, be as easily accessible.
Or go on Snapchat and actually shoot a story and have people be able to go on Snapchat and see that story on their timeline. I mean, I think the thing I want to continue to bang my head against, because even as an educator, I find myself wrestling with this conversation often, as I keep thinking of these mediums as ways to get information out. And I find that my students have this information. They can put it in context to their life at the moment in a way that I can't, in a way that is actually of them, with them, and about them. And having them as the voice and the person to tell those complicated stories allows for that information to volley back and forth in a way that doesn't feel prescribed or like I'm preaching to them. And the reason for that is because, for example, we keep talking about the South, but it's very difficult for people to think about where I'm from as the South. Florida is the South,
no.
And has the third largest population of black people in the country. Georgia and I think Texas or Louisiana is the third, right? So, but people don't know that about Florida. They think about Florida, they think about jiggly sandy beaches and gators, right? And so from the land that produced Zora Neale Hurston, one of the greatest minds in African-American literature, it's important for me or to make sure that the young people who are of that ilk know their heritage, know that lineage. And so I bring it into a social construct because that's a part of the problem. If we keep talking about it in numbers and stigma and as in information and not as a cultural phenomenon, sickness is a part of human condition. People get sick. And if it's not a part of the tapestry with which we tell our stories and understand ourselves, it will always remain outside of our conversations, outside of who we are.
And I think the self-shooting movement, we're going to see more and more like on MTV and other networks where we're giving cameras, just as you said, to people, because it's one thing for sort of the media to make the stories, or the traditional media to make the stories, and it's quite another for, as you're saying, young people to make their own stories that can really compel social change. So it's about everyone telling the stories, and that's what I think we're going to see a lot more. I'm hearing about it a lot, that there are going to be a lot more self-shot shows that are coming on.
One of the things that we're doing at the Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation is we fund a it's right here out of UCLA called Sex Squad, and it's run by Dr. David Gere. And what it is, it's theater art performance about and the stories. Zach, who works with us at ETAF, was one of the Sex Squad. That's how we met him. But they get together in an intensive weekend, and they talk about their own sexual health, and they create these theater pieces. They might be spoken word, they might be dance, they might be, and then they perform them not just for UCLA, but they have a program where they go out into the LA Unified School System, and they actually perform for 10th grades. They also, through a grant from Elizabeth Taylor AIDS Foundation, now tape them, and they can, then they're part of curriculum because they're college kids who have courses. They can't go to every 10th grade class in LA Unified. And the numbers of showing students paying attention, because it's what you said, it's from them, by them, for them, in their language, and the numbers are really, really fantastic. And so we've actually now, working with David and UCLA, we're expanding that program. It's actually already afoot in North Carolina, with UNC and Duke, and you're going to learn about this in a little bit, but we're going to have you go down. So the next thing we're going to do is we're actually going to have a meeting of superintendents in North Carolina that you're going to go give them hell, and we're going to get them to use that curriculum in the school. So.
I want to say one last thing, because you asked about Christina.
Yeah.
So the little girl, I fell in love with her. I get attached very easily to children, and she
was 12, right, at the time?
13.
Okay.
And so I ended up going to every school play and over to her and her mother's house all the time, and she was born with it. And her father, who passed away not long after she was born, they didn't know what it was. He got very sick very quickly. He goes into the hospital. They find out he's got AIDS, and he died almost immediately. And then they tested her mother and the baby, and they both had it. These women are two of the most incredible, because she is a woman now. She just graduated from Berkeley with her master's. She is undetectable. But this is the part about where kids teach the older generations, maybe in the older generation in this story. So high school, she's 16, there's a guy she's got a crush on, and her mom calls me and goes, I don't know what to do. Kids are so mean, I don't want her to get her heart broken. So I went over to the house and I said, tell me about this boy, what's happening? And she, and her mom's like this. And I said, lady, get out. Go to In-N-Out, which is where Christina works at the time. And so she got out, and Christina proceeded to tell me that she had a crush on this boy, and the boy asked her out, and she'd been on a couple of dates. And she didn't want to be dishonest with him. She wanted to tell him the truth, because she goes, I know it's, you know, that kids my age have sex, and while I'm not ready yet, I want to be honest with him, and I'm like, are you crazy? No, we're not. If you're not going to have sex, then you don't need to be that honest about that right this second. Let's see how this works out. Well, she taught me a lesson. They are, did they get married yet?
They're engaged.
They're engaged. They're still together. This was 20 years ago? That just aged the hell out of me, didn't
it? Yeah. Not 20 years.
It was a very long time ago.
15, 16 years ago. Yeah.
I was 20, 39, it's fine. I'm as 20. But I think if we get the kids talking to the kids, like you said, because they're essentially the ones that are teaching us. Mm-hmm. It's like how I taught my family. You know, we all have to do that, but we had sex education in school then. They don't have it now. And so I think that's something that we really need to work towards also, aside from what we can do in our community as far as writing and acting and producing. We also just need to be able to have some kind of a cause or fund or whatever where we can raise money to actually get the education back into the school systems.
But you know what, Jaime? It's not the kids. The kids got it.
Oh,
it's their parents
who
need to be educated. It's the parents who need to be sitting in those rooms, getting the current statistics and learning more so that they have a better understanding, because they're reprimanding their children for things that they don't fully understand. So before we go there,
I agree,
because the kids, they're on it.
But the question is, how do you get adults? I mean, the kids have to go to school.
Mm-hmm.
How do we get the parents to have to go to school? That's the big issue.
That's the creative part. That's where we have to be creative in seducing them into the room. It's gonna take a moment, but they're the ones who need more education.
Yeah, I would jump in to say that I've heard a lot about social media here. Neophyte in social media, barely am on Facebook. And I think it could be a powerful tool, you know, peers talking to peers through social media. But I'm somebody who still watches the network news and reads two newspapers in the morning and television. And that's where I'm going to, my mind can be changed by what I see in television and the movies.
Tell your story.
Telling your story is liberating. Studs
right.
Terkel said that when he interviewed people his whole life. And when people told their own story, it meant I matter. And that's really important. So you have to tell your story.
We all do. And I think, and that's a great note for me to say thank you to each of you for opening your heart and telling your story. And to everybody who came and just died, thank you. Thank you.